Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I'm really honored with this presentation because it's a hot topic, it's an actual topic, it's a very important topic, and it's something we unfortunately deal with on a daily basis almost. Just to give you a flavor of what happens if a very active, young, healthy individual encounter something like sudden death or syncope on the field. I'll show you just this short movie I borrowed from the Belgium TV.
Antonio Cuerta, de 22-jarige Spaanse middenvelder van UEFA Cup winnaar FC Sevilla, is overleden. Cuerta werd zaterdag plots onwel tijdens de competitiewedstrijd tegen Getafe. Cuerta verloor even het bewustzijn, maar kon wel nog op eigen kracht het veld verlaten. In de kleedkamer verslechterde zijn toestand heel snel en hij werd overgebracht naar het ziekenhuis, waar hij dus deze namiddag is overleden.
De slotminuten van de wedstrijd Guimaraes-Benfica. 0-1 voor Benfica, de ploeg in het rood. De Hongaarse spits Miklós Feher staat als invaller al een half uur op het veld en doet iets doms om tijd te winnen. Hij krijgt terecht geel. Wat volgt is verschrikkelijk en behoeft alleen stilte. Hartstilstand luidt het officieel. Dokters snellen toe, de ontreddering in het stadion is enorm. De reanimatiepogingen op het veld geven nog een sprankelhoop op een goede afloop, maar de speler overlijdt in het ziekenhuis. Volgens de clubdokter had hij geen hartproblemen. Miklós Feher was 24 en speelde al 5 jaar in Portugal. Hij was Hongaars international en scoorde 6 keer in 18 interlands.
So I've shown this several times, and every time it's still very emotional because this shouldn't happen, and still it does. This is not new. First report of a sudden death was the guy that ran the first marathon, and we're talking before Christ. But this is actually happening still in this modern times, and these are all examples of football players. Antonio Puerta, who walked down the field, died a few hours later, it was not able to save his life, apparently. More recently, in April, Morosini, a good Italian player, died suddenly. It does not only happen in football. In the US, it's more the basketball players and football players. In Europe, it's cycling and football, soccer, actually. These are young guys from our country that unfortunately died at very young age. And this Rob Horis died 2 days ago in the Tour de France. Suddenly, he was not an actual competitor at that time, but he was just visiting. He's a hockey player that switched over to cycling, and he died at the age of 30. So it's a hot topic. It just happened 2 days ago. What is always striking is the terminology. Of course, we get our TV frames from the lay press, and they use all kinds of terminology. But even in our colleagues, sport doctors, I saw the news, the sport doctor of the team of Rob Horis explaining after the facts on TV, and he was talking about heart failure, and we don't know what happens, and we don't know if sports really increases the risk. So this was a little bit unfortunate. We have data. And because this was probably in the moment after he heard the news, but afterwards on TV he had a very good explanation. But the the wording is very often wrong. They talk about cardiac standstill here, and it was confirmed by autopsy. It's maybe a little bit disrespectful, but I hope it was confirmed by autopsy that the heart is standing still. But what is causing it, that is often the question. Multiple causes result in the same effect, and that is sudden death. And usually, 9 out of 10, it's ventricular arrhythmias. And what is happening, we don't know exactly, but most of the time there is something there. There was something there, a substrate, we call that. Either anatomically, there's something wrong with the heart, if you can see the heart, or electrical, there's something wrong with the heart rhythm, and there were probably signs before that the heart rhythm was something that could become unstable. And of course, during extreme sports, you have all kinds of physiologic effect that can affect these arrhythmias and lead to ventricular arrhythmias. But usually there is something there, and that's the topic is today, can we prevent it? Can we screen our athletes? And that's what we need to look for. Do we have any data? Because sometimes some people say, well, we don't know what the scope of the problem is. And of course, it's on TV, but it's 1 out of 100,000 sporters. So it's ridiculous to try to screen something. Well, we do have some data, and I'll come back to that. What I always also want to point out is, what is the underlying pathology in most of the cases or several of the cases? How should we screen? And this accounts for the young athletes, someone of 10 years old, 12 years old, 14, when should we start? What to do with a 50-year-old who is really cycling as hell? Is he still healthy? And then the professional sporters. And if we have some time, we just touch on, do we need an AED in the sports facility? And can someone with an ICD, a defibrillator, can he still be an athlete? Just, that is very short. We know a lot about sudden death in the general population. Unfortunately, we deal with this all the time as electrophysiologists, and if someone has a huge myocardial infarction at the age of 60, he is at risk for sudden death in the year after, in 5 years after. But we know that it's not a small problem. It's 2 out of 1,000 patient years. And usually the problem, the underlying problem, is ischemic heart disease or a dilated cardiomyopathy. That means the heart is enlarged and doesn't function anymore. And there is an index event. When does the ticking of the clock starts? Well, at the moment of the first infarction, at the moment of the first heart failure. So we know a lot of the general population dying suddenly. But do we know anything about the athletes? Well, we have luckily some good data from Italy. Why is that? Because in 1979 already, they mandatory started a screening program for athletes, for young athletes. And I come back to this curve later on in the screening, but they have a pretty good idea how many sporters or athletes die on the field. And it's about 2.3 per 100,000 athletes a year. You might say it's not much, but it's worth preventing, I think. What they also saw, that the athletes have a higher risk, 2.5 times, and this are data from a French study, 4.5 times, more risk of dying suddenly than someone who doesn't do sports. And the risk is much higher in male than in female. So these are data, and we can start our screening program on that. Now, we are not going to hang our head on one study. These are data from the U.S. military, 1 out of 9,000 retrospective study. This is the Italian study, U.S. adolescents. And you see that the number, the incidence is a wide scatter, from 1 out of 9,000 to 1 out of 160,000. Depends, of course, how you look at the program. These U.S. athletes, well, that's retrospective public media report. So this doesn't cover nearly all the deaths, of course. In the military, they have a much closer look at their recruits. So it's a quite range, but I think we can work with about 2.3 in 100,000, and in some regions they say 0.5 per 100,000 years. Now, what is the underlying problem? Oh, just to an interesting thought, what are the sports where the sudden death is most likely, in Europe at least? Soccer, cycling, running, and then it decreases. And golf, it's less than 1%. So it definitely also has to do with the level of training, the level of exercise, as you can see here. The underlying disease, well, we know a lot about that. If you reach the age of 35, you cannot consider yourself a young athlete anymore, unfortunately, for most of us. And then the most likely reason for a sudden death during sport is coronary artery disease. That's the because of the way we live and that we use a lot of cholesterol. Some people smoke and sport, all these things. But above 35 years old, you should really think about a coronary disease. But it's in the young, the kids, the young athletes, that you have totally different spectrum of sudden death. And that is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. There is coronary artery anomalies. I'll show you that. ARVD, particularly prevalent in Italy. So I'll come back to that. This is a slide from the US literature, and you see a big part of the sudden deaths are due to hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This is mainly in the Afro-Americans, quite prevalent. Also not unimportant, myocarditis, and if you look in, this is a European study, infectious. There are some people that where we do an autopsy after sudden death, and we see there's a clear myocarditis, a clear infection. So if your top sporter has a clear infection, be careful that he stops for a few days doing his extreme exercise. So just to show you some examples. This is my first example. This was a basketball player that joined a Belgium first-class team, and he dropped down during training. He just fainted, and it didn't last too long. So he was referred for further testing, and this was his ECG. And you see quite tall complexes. I'm not sure if you're all very familiar with reading the ECG, but it's tall complexes, and you see negative T waves in this area, inferior, and in this area, anterior. This is a sign of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And what is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy? That means that the heart muscle starts growing where it usually is 1.2 or 1.3 centimeters. It can become 2 to 3 centimeters. And this is not because of sports, this is a genetic disorder. But these athletes are at risk for sudden death because this substrate is prone to arrhythmias. And sometimes they have symptoms like dyspnea, and these are things that you need to ask in your screening protocol. Dyspnea on exertion, angina, chest pain. Sometimes, and this is a very important sign, a presyncope or a syncope during training. Fatigue not explained by the things that they did. And sometimes they have a family history of sudden death, which is also a very important question to ask an athlete, if there is a family history of sudden death before the age of 50. They have some physical abnormalities on physical exam. For example, they usually have a heart murmur, and you can even evoke the heart murmur. Now, there's always a discussion between the US and Europe on whether we should use the ECG for screening. Now, this study from Bob Meyerberg showed that in just 22 hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients, if you just listen to the heart and do a physical exam, you pick out 1 out of 4. But if you add the ECG, you pick out 80 or almost 90% in some studies. So in this particular pathology, the ECG is quite useful as a screening tool. Another case, a very young cyclist who during a sprint suddenly, well, they use all kind of terminology, the cyclists. They say my legs started hurting and my legs didn't want to do what I was intended to do. And he fainted almost. He didn't fall, but he fainted almost. And after the finish, he had to sit down and lie down. Well, it was during exercise, so we take that serious. And when you look at his ECG, you see, first of all, that there's an extra systole. And you might say, well, we see that in so many athletes. That's true. And there are possibilities of discriminating this. But there is a ventricular extra systole. But what is more important is that you see here on the left, on the right side of the heart, the V1, 2, and 3, that are the electrodes that we put over the right ventricle, you see negative T waves. And this is something we see in kids up till the age of 10, but not in adults, unless there's something wrong with the right ventricle. And this and another sign was in this lead is that there's a small epsilon wave. So whenever you are not looking for this, you won't see it, but we, of course, know what to look for. And when you put this guy on an exercise test, he started developing ventricular arrhythmias, and this is, of course, not his heart, but on autopsy, you see a fatty infiltration of the muscle. So it's not muscle anymore, it's fatty, and particularly the right ventricle. This is the muscle that we should have at this moment. This is the muscle that you have when you have this disease. So it's infiltrated with fat. And there the arrhythmias occur. So they can have symptoms. Dyspnea, the same thing. Less exercise tolerance, syncope, fatigue. But the first sign could be sudden death in 17% of these individuals. So it's a really worthwhile screening. And there's one important question. This was a genetic disorder, but can we induce right ventricular pathology by extensive training? Well, there are some hints, and it's further elaborated, but there's a study from the 90s where they just took an echo at the finish of the Ironman, and they saw an acute increase in right ventricle systolic and diastolic dimensions. A right ventricle is not made to push heavy pressure, so it will dilate very soon, very often, and then you can have fibrosis and problems. And a study here in Belgium looking at athletes, cyclists that had problems, syncope during sport, ventricular arrhythmias, well, 90% had real problems in the right ventricle. 9 of them died suddenly, 9 of them got an ICD, and 6 got appropriate shocks soon after the implantations, and all were during exercise. So we think that there's definitely an entity, right ventricular cardiomyopathy, genetic, runs in families, but we might induce some right ventricular pathology by intensive training. So we have to be careful for that. One more example. I'm going to take a look at the time, make sure that I don't cross my welcome here. Okay. This is a female, and she did a syncope while swimming. So not after she came out of the pool, but she was swimming and she went down. And the first ECG that she ever had showed this. What is remarkable, you see a very long repolarization from Q to the end of the T wave. So it's a long QT. And unfortunately, her young sister, years before, died while riding a horse at 16 years old. So, and it was unexplained. So long QT, it's a genetic disease once again. And what is important for sports participation, that if they have a sympathetic drive, for example, the ringing of the alarm in the morning, or swimming, or exercise, they can have arrhythmias at that moment. So another quick example, and then I go over to the screening. This was a 40-year-old marathon runner, and it already happened in 2005. The guy was running and did several syncopes, and during his run he did another syncope, and his friend who was running with him took him by car to the hospital. Well, he did a new syncope, he called the ambulance, and by arrival in the ER he did a spontaneous ventricular fibrillation, and he was cardioverted, so he was really lucky. We thought, 48 years old, he must have coronary disease, so we rushed him to the cath lab, but there were no stenosis, but it was an aberrant origin of the right coronary. I'll try to show you that. This is the aorta, and normally you should have the left main here and the right coronary here, but as you can see, the right coronary comes from the left, so that's not a big deal. The coronaries were normal, but as you can see on this slide, this coronary gets sometimes pinched between the aorta and the pulmonary artery, and this can cause ischemia and rhythm problems. Now, this is unfortunately something we cannot see on ECG. The first three we definitely can't see. We cannot afford to miss, actually, but we cannot see this on ECG. This happens suddenly. This is the last one, what we do see on ECG. Any idea what this is? A 16-year-old soccer player complaining of palpitations, sudden fast heart rhythms. Well, you see that the ECG is not normal. It's quite wide, and you see what we call a delta wave. So this young soccer player has a WPW. And they can do these rhythms very easily if they have some atrial fibrillation. The Kent bundle, what we call the extra bundle in the heart, will conduct very fast, and they can die suddenly. So this is something we definitely need to pick out. It can be ablated, so we just can cure this, but this can lead to sudden death, and especially in young male players. Now, not everything is should be a small movie coming up. Well, I'll skip that anyway. Not everything is preventable. This is a karate fight, and the young guy, he got a blow in the chest, and he went back to his line, and then he collapsed. So contusion of the heart can also create ventricular fibrillation. Now, where is that important in screening? Of course, we cannot screen for these things. Sport regulations can try to minimize blunt chest traumas. But we can screen for a particular disease where even a small touch can cause some harm, and that is Marfan syndrome. Marfan syndrome is a disease where the aorta and the vessels are quite vulnerable, and these people have particular features, like they have very long arms, they have arachnodactyly, that means that they can bend their fingers up to the arm. Not this way, but the other way. They have lens problems, and they have heart murmurs. And they should not do any contact sports because they have a very fragile vessels, and they can die of the same reason as the guy in the karate kit. So, to answer our questions, we know how many athletes approximately, we know what the diseases are that we have to look for. One particular thing, what is the index event? If we experience acute myocardial infarction, our clock is ticking and the risk is high in the beginning. What is that in sports people? Well, this is the death of Serginho, a soccer player, and what was in the press was that he was recently found to have a cardiac problem, but there was no correct diagnosis yet. So there was something already. Another one, one of our cyclists, he collapsed during a game and he lost his life, but he experienced a syncope 2 weeks earlier, also during a training or during a game or a cycling match. Well, a syncope during exercise is a real bad sign for us. We really should check those people that do syncopes during exercise, because this can be the beginning of a problem. So palpitation, shortness of breath, or syncope during exercise, that's what we call the index event. Then you really should be careful. Good, so to set up screening programs, well, It's a large-scale operation. There are so many million sporters. Luckily, there are athletes. It's healthy to do sports. But it raises the issue of cost-benefit. And some people would say, well, why bother? You might save one person a year. And others say, well, it's definitely worthwhile to save a 20-year-old sportsman. So it's a large-scale operation. It should be uniform, though. There's checking and screening by everyone, from family physician to sports medicine to cardiologists, even nurses. And I'm not saying they're not doing it well, but it's not uniform. You should know what to look for. It should be a very uniform program with skilled and trained personnel, and that is really important, I think. Should you make it mandatory? Should you make it recommended? That's also an ethical and a legal issue. And what do the athletes do with the advice? Do they have to listen to you when you say, I'm sorry, you cannot do any sports anymore? The first thing they will do is go shopping. They go to another doctor. So compliance is also a problem. So for screening, you need a specific history on the family and personal history. You need a specific physical exam. You probably need, and we really advise that, you need an ECG. There are false positives and even false negatives. That's also important. You can miss something on ECG, and you will not prevent every sudden death. And that is very important to know, that a patient, if he's screened and something happened, well, you cannot always predict. So there are false negatives. Should we use echo? Well, some advocate it, but I don't think it's quite useful as a screening tool. Should we use exercise test? Well, that we should use in the elderly population. I'm sorry for the plus 35s. I'm one of them. there are guidelines on that. If you are sedentary and you do low intense activity, let's say golf or something like that, and you don't feel anything, well, you can go and continue sporting. If you feel, of course, some problems, you should have your heart checked. If you do high-intensity sports like cycling, you should have a check. And then we use the risk score, and that is family history, cholesterol, smoking, all these things. And if you are low risk, you can sport. If you're high risk, you need an exercise test. And another example is from the American College of Sports Medicine. It depends on your exercise level. If it's moderate exercise and you're young, you don't need any testing. But if you have real vigorous exercise, you need any testing older than 40. And of course, if you have symptoms. If you already have problems, you need extra testing. So exercise test will be tailored to the patient or to the athlete. Now, do we reach something with screening? Well, this is a very nice example from Italy. They started in 79. These are sedentary people, not athletes. And you see, they also have a risk of dying. You cannot prevent everything. But the athletes had a higher risk, and by a thorough screening, the risk came down even below the risk of the sedentary people. So you can definitely save some lives. You can definitely do something. And this study was backed up by an Israeli study. They started screening here, and they saw the same drastic drop in sudden death here that was before and after. So there are definitely some data on the value of screening. There is difference between European and U.S. regulations or advices. We use the 12 lead, and one point that it's usually brought up is, well, there are so many. This is an athlete heart. This is not pathology. If you train very hard, you get all kinds of ECG abnormalities. You get a slow heart rate. We all know that. We sometimes see a V block. We sometimes see other changes. So it's very hard to distinguish. And it's very often, especially with these sports, in 40% you see in the cyclists, you see an abnormality. And this is a very complicated slide, but an athlete's heart and a pathology, there's a gray area where we don't know if it's really training. And what we advise then is, of course, detraining, deconditioning, and then we can see if it's an athlete's heart, it disappears. All right, so one more question on the screening. How many people are we going to ground or forbid sport unnecessary? Well, this is an example to 33,000 patients or sportsmen, I always say patients, sorry for that, athletes screened. 600 were disqualified, so 1.8%. So it's not nothing, but it's not much. All right, the advice, this guy was told not to sport anymore, and unfortunately he continued. He was transferred to another team, and he died during a game. Our official regulations, the Olympic Committee really say that you should screen. The FIFA had a meeting in May, and the only thing they said is that you need an ambulance and you need an AED. And that was, if there is a football match, you need a defibrillator, an external defibrillator. If you don't have one, you better get a coffin. So that was the main message. But they didn't say anything about screening. So really, I really checked the website of the FIFA. I found nothing about screening, and I saw this title discussed in Budapest. I said, now they're going to start screening. No, it was more about the AED. It's of course important, but you should do more. You should prevent. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wagen. Before I call the next speaker to the stage, I have an announcement to make. We are now noting the names who had not registered for the banquet and request for some leftover tickets. So those that have made a reservation, you still have time just after this plenary session to pick up your reserved ticket. If not, we are going to give them to people that are on the waiting list. Oh, this is good. At noon, a waiting list. Next speaker, Barbara Ainsworth. I know Barbara as my president at ACSM when I came in as a board member. We have a very prominent person with us here. I'm glad that there are three former presidents of ACSM present at this conference, at the European conference. This means that we are getting closer and closer together. Further, Barbara has a strong curriculum. She's professor in exercise and wellness program and associate director for health promotion faculties in the School of Nutrition and Health Promotion at Arizona State University. Research of Barbara relates especially to physical activity and public health, with a focus on the assessment of physical activity in population, the evaluation of physical activity questionnaires, and physical activity in women. But she's best known as the lead author for the compendium of physical activities and the all the other statements and position statements you were co-author and lead on. So Barbara, would you please come to the stage?